privilege to introduce to you the author of more than a dozen books of poetry, numerous novels, children's books, collections of essays, and a recent memoir. Maxine Heumann has been one of the most esteemed and most loved voices in American literature for the past four decades. Her work has won her numerous awards, including the Pulitzer Prize for Poetry. She has served as poetry consultant to the Library of Congress, the position now entitled U.S. Poet Laureate, and as Chancellor of the Academy of American Poets. For the past 40 years, she has lived on a 200-acre farm in New Hampshire, where she and her husband, Victor, have raised Arabian and standard breed horses. In 1999, at age 74, her life drastically changed when she was nearly killed in a horse-driving accident. 95% of those with this injury don't make it to the hospital, her doctor told her. Of those who do, 95% are quadriplegic. Her remarkable memoir, Inside the Halo and Beyond, The Anatomy of a Recovery, tells that story of surviving a broken neck, what's known as the hangman's fracture, a punctured lung, 11 broken ribs, and more. As part of her recovery, she also endured 3 months in a halo, a metal apparatus screwed unmercifully into the skull. That Maxine Heumann will walk up to this podium is testament that she is more than a survivor. She is a fighter and a thriver. Her poetry, imbued with that same spirit, is likewise filled with fight and with love, with passion and with compassion. Heumann once said of her poetry, "I suppose it could be called pastoral, but not a romanticized pastoral. It has real manure in it, and real rain, and real anguish and loss, just as much as it has some of the sunny hours. Straightforward in voice, direct in style, her accomplished work has always been concerned with the natural world of which the human is a part. While her work celebrates the solace of nature, her ecological and historical awareness refuses to let us forget how we have destroyed the very thing which offers us refuge." Poems such as Bringing Down the Birds, in which Heumann catalogs species exterminated for such grand purposes as acquiring feathers for mattress stuffing, force us to confront our often uncomfortable history, a past which, perhaps most disturbing, hasn't passed at all. She asks, if science could reconstruct them, how long would it take us logging and drilling and storing up treasures to do them all in again? As central as the pastoral to her work is human social consciousness. Whether she focuses her clear vision on our treatment of the natural world or on our treatment of each other, as when she writes of atrocities such as terror by amputation in Sierra Leone, committed and justified by the name of war. For more than four decades, her poetry has been telling our story as residents on a beautiful planet we've too often marred by violence. What gives us hope that the human may, in spite of it all, be redeemable, lies in the beauty and the grace and the moral intelligence of this telling. Please welcome Maxine Heumann.
Canadian Pacific Northwest in the parks of Banff, Jasper, and at Lake Louise. The title of the pamphlet and the title of the poem I was singing, "You Are in Bear Country." They've been here for thousands of years. You're the visitor. Avoid encounters. Think ahead. Keep clear of berry patches, garbage dumps, carcasses. On woods walks, bring noisemakers, bells, clap hands along the trail or sing. But in dense bush or by running water, bear may not hear your clatter. Whatever else, don't whistle. Whistling is thought by some to imitate the sounds bears make when they mate. You need to know there are two kinds, Ursus arctus horribilis or grizzly, and Ursus americanus, the smaller black, said to be somewhat less likely to attack. Alas, a small horribilis is difficult to distinguish from a large americanus. Although there is no guaranteed life-saving way to deal with an aggressive bear, some ploys have proved more successful than others. Running's a poor choice. Bear can outrun a racehorse. Once you're face to face, speak softly. Take off your pack and set it down to distract the grizzly. Meanwhile, back slowly toward a large, sparsely branched tree. But remember, black bears are agile climbers, in which case a tree may not offer escape. As a last resort, you can play dead, drop to the ground, face down. In this case, wearing your pack may shield your body from attack. Courage, lie still. Sometimes your bear may veer away. If not, bears have been known to inflict only minor injuries upon the prone. Is death by bear to be preferred to death by bomb? Under these extenuating circumstances, your mind may make absurd leaps. The answer is yes. Come on in. Cherish your wilderness. Now, the next... the next poem, the man is on the ground. And it is called In the Park. Seemed really to lead very, very instinctively, or intuitively, I guess I should say, into this next one. I don't think it's my eyesight, I think it's, here we go. I'm reading from the selected piece. In the Park, I like to read this to academic audiences because it talks about the difference between lie and lay, which I heard rumors that the president is going to declare the distinction obsolete this year. In the Park, you have 49 days between death and rebirth if you're a Buddhist. Even the smallest soul could swim the English Channel in that time, or climb like a 10-month-old child every step of the Washington Monument to travel across, up, down, over, or through. You won't know till you get there which to do. He laid on me for a few seconds, said Roscoe Black, who lived to tell about his skirmish with a grizzly bear in Glacier Park. He laid on me, not doing anything. I could feel his heart beating against my heart. Never mind lie and lay, the whole world confuses them. For Roscoe Black, you might say all 49 days flew by. I was raised on the Old Testament. In it, God talks to Moses, Noah, Samuel, and they answer. People confer with angels, certain animals converse with humans. It's a simple world full of crossovers. Heaven's an airy somewhere, and God has a nasty temper when provoked. But if there's a hell, little is made of it. No long-tailed devil, no eternal fire, and no choosing what to come back as. When the grizzly bear appears, he lays down on atheist and zealot. In the pitch dark, each of us waits for him in Glacier Park. Going on the assumption that many of you have taken a course in Shakespeare or perhaps encountered this play when you were in high school, I'd like to read a poem that I wrote about Romeo and Juliet. When my daughters were, maybe 11 and 12, I took them to an Old Vic repertory production of Romeo and Juliet. This was in Boston, Mass. And it was a Saturday matinee, and the audience had all been bussed in from high schools and prep schools, and they were all eating candy and rattling the wrappers and eating popcorn. Nobody was paying much attention to what was going on stage except for me, and I sobbed audibly during the fifth act. And when the curtain fell and the lights came up, my daughters went out to the aisle either side of me and pretended they had no idea who I was. On the drive home, the kinder one said to me, "It was only a play, Mother." And the less kind one said, "I have never been so humiliated." So I wrote a Shakespearean sonnet, which I've titled Purgatory, trying to imagine what Romeo and Juliet would have been like if it had been written as a comedy, that is to say, a play with a happy ending instead of a tragedy. And it, as I said, it is a Shakespearean sonnet, so you all know, of course, the rhyme scheme. But I'm going to gloss one of the rhyme words. It's room, but it's R-H-E-U-M, which is an old-fashioned word for a bad cold. Purgatory. And suppose the darlings get to Mantua? Suppose they cheat the crypt? What next? Begin with him unshaven, though not, I grant you, a displeasing cockerel. There's egg yolk on his chin, his seedy robes aflap. He's got the room. Poor dear, the cooking lard has smoked her eye. Another Montague is in the womb, although the first babe's bottom is not yet dry. She scrolls a weekly letter to her nurse, who dares to send a smock through Balthazar. And once a month, his father posts a purse. News from Verona, always news of war. Such sour years it takes to right this wrong. The fifth act runs unconscionably long. At one time in the Upcountry book, which Dr. Meek referred to, I wrote a whole cycle of Kermit poems. And they're all written in the male persona, although, of course, I was the hermit. But I didn't think the world, this would have been in the very early 70s, I didn't think the world was ready to take a female hermit seriously. So we are now approaching fall, and I guess it would be appropriate. Do you have skunks in you have some two-legged ones, too. This is called The Hermit Meets the Skunk. The hermit's dog skitters home, drunk with it once every fall. The whites of his eyes marbled from the spray, and his tail tucked tighter than a clamshell. He contracts himself to a mouse under the hermit's bed. The hermit unsticks him with a broom and ties him outside to a tree. He is a spotted dog, black rampant on white. And as the hermit scrubs, the white goes satiny with lava soap. The black brightens to a bootblack shine. Next, the dose of tomato juice stains the white like a razor cut under water and purples the black. And after that, the whole dog bleaches moon-colored under a drench of cornstarch. The hermit sniffs him, Skunk is still plain as a train announcement. So he is to be washed again, rinsed again, powdered again, until the spots wink out again under the neutral white. Inside his mouth, the hermit knows, and knows from what is visible under the tail, dog is equally spotted, but in the interior, gray on a pink field. If he were to be pinned down, his four legs held at four corners and slit open by the enthusiast, the hermit knows the true nature of dog, spotted layer by layer, would be laid bare. Afterward, all night, Skunk sleepwalks the house. Skunk is a pot of copper pennies scorched dry on a high flame. Skunk is a porridge of dead shrews stewed down to gelatin. Skunk is the bloat of chicken gut left 10 days to sweeten in the sun. Skunk is the mother bed, the ripe taste of carrion, the green kiss. Lost again. This next poem is written in rhyming couplets, and it's kind of a signature poem. I swim all summer long. I mean, I swim as soon as the pond is warm enough to swim, and then I swim until it's too cold to swim, and then I drive to the next town where there's a beautiful Olympic-sized pool, and then I start swimming again. But as I said this afternoon, swimming in the public pool wearing a bathing suit feels like swimming, I don't know, in a cloak of some sort. So this is how I swim, morning swim. Into my empty head there come a cotton beach, a dot wherefrom I set out, oily and nude through mist in chilly solitude. There was no line, no roof or floor to tell the water from the air. Night fog, thick as terry cloth, closed me in its fuzzy breath. I hung my bathrobe on two pegs. I took the lake between my legs. Invaded and invader, I went overhead on that flat sky. Fish twitched beneath me, quick and tame. In their green zone, they sang my name. And in the rhythm of the swim, I hummed a 2-4-time slow hymn. I hummed, abide with me. The beat rose in the fine thrash of my feet, rose in the bubbles I put out slantwise, trailing through my mouth. My bones drank water, water fell through all my doors. I was the well that fed the lake that met my sea, in which I sang, abide. Well, this is a water poem of sorts. It's really a prayer called Watering Trough. Let the end of all bathtubs be this putting out to pasture of 4 Victorian bow legs anchored in grasses. Let all long-necked browsers come drink from the shallows while faucets grow rusty and porcelain yellow. Where once our nude forebears soaked up in this vessel, come cows and come horses, bring burdock and thistle, come slaver the scum of timothy and clover on the cast iron lip that our grandsires climbed over, and let there be always green water for sipping, that mussels may enter thoughtful and rise dripping. Well, because Sandy read that quote that said, my poems have real manure in them, I'm going to read the expert poem, 196. It has a 4-letter word in it, so if you need to cover your ears, you can do that. It is done by us all as God disposes from the least cast of worm. What must have been in the case of the brontosaur, say, spore of considerable heft, something awesome. We evacuate survivors that we are. I think these things each morning with shovel and rake, drawing the risen brown bones toward me, fresh from a horse oven, as it were. And wheeling to it, storming up the slope, I think of the angle of repose the manure pile assumes, how sparrows come to pick the redelivered grain, how inky cap caprinus mushrooms spring up in the downpour. I think of what drops from us and must then be moved to make way for the next and next. However much we stain the world, spatter it with our leavings, make stenches, defile the great formal oceans with what leaks down, trundling off today's last barrowful, I honor ship for saying, we go on. I wrote a series of mother-daughter poems at one point. I'm just going to read one of them. Actually, this is my sex misinformation poem. So this poem is really obsolete because any smart three-year-old can tell you where babies come from. But when I was a child, there was an enormous mythology surrounding this subject. And this is what my child mind did with the spotty information I was given. It's called the birthday poem because I wrote it for my mother's birthday. She was 82, I think, when I wrote this. I am born at home, the last of four children. The doctor brings me, as promised, in his snap-jawed black leather satchel. He takes me out in sections, fastens limbs to torso, torso to neck stem, pries mama's navel open, and inserts me head first. Chin back, I swim upward, up the alimentary canal, bypassing mouth and nose holes, and knock at the top of her head to be let out, wherefore her little bald spot. Today, my mother is 82, splendidly braceleted and wigged. She had to go four times to the well to get me. Two cords of stove-length oak and wait on the old enclosed front porch to make the swap. November sun revives the thick, trapped buzz of horseflies. The siren for noon and forest fires blows a sliding scale. The lamb of woe looks in at me through glass on the last day of her life. Geranium scraps from the window box trail from her mouth. Burdock burrs are stickered to her fleece like chicken pox. Under her tail stub, permanent smears. I think of how it goes on, this dark, particular bend of our hungers. The way wire eats into a tree year after year on the pasture's perimeter, keeping the milk cows penned until they grow too old to freshen. Of how the last wild horses were scoured from canyons in Idaho, roped, their nostrils twisted shut with wire to keep them down, the mares aborting, days later, all of them carted into town. I think of how it will be in January, nights so cold the pond ice cracks like target practice, daylight blue color, sleep falling, my yellow horse slick with the ball bearing sleep, raising up from his dingy brows out of boredom, habit to strip bark from the fenced-in trees. Of February, month of the hard palate, the split wood running out, worms working in the flower bed. The lamb whose time has come goes off in a cab of the dump truck, tied to the seat with baling twine, durable enough to bear her to the knife and rafter. O lambs, the whole wolf world sits down to eat and cleans its muzzle after. Well, I might call that my vegetarian protest. I'm going to read the... very self-indulgent poem, because it's a grandmother poem. Although this baby is now a junior at Harvard, how time flies. But the setting is Geneva, Switzerland, right on the border with France, and the poem is called We Stood There Singing. On a gray day in March in his first year, we drove up out of orderly Geneva, mother and daughter and the daughter's child, up the hairpin turns of the Chasseurs, in search of the horses of the Franche Montaigne, with feathered fetlocks and manes blown wild, each splashed white face the same kind eye, said to persist unchanged since Charlemagne. The baby slept tip sideways in his chair, slept through sudden snow squalls that blanked the Alpine road like a staged scrim, and woke up cranky in Les Poulets, where at the village's one store we stopped to take our bearings. When he howled, the aproned woman invited us back past vats of sauerkraut and wheels of cheese into their bedroom. I remember that plain space of rough white plaster, oaken crucifix, oak beams overhead, runner of tatted lace on the chest of drawers. I remember the lambskin she unrolled on the bed, motioning you to lay him down. And after he was done up, sweet with powder, she opened her arms and bounced him chortling around the room, singing him bits of Le Bon Roi d'Agobert. We stood there singing. I remember that moment of civility among them. Now I'd like to read some poems from the new book, A Long Marriage, which opens with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 poems that either, I suppose you would call them apostrophes, which is to say addressed to the dead or absent individual. And I'm going to read the first one, which is called Skinny Dipping of William Wordsworth. Unfortunately, you can't see it on the page where the little italicized bits are taken from the poems. So I'll just go like this when I pick one of them. Skinny Dipping with William Wordsworth. I lie by the pond in utter nakedness, thinking of you, Will, your epiphanies of woodcock, raven, rills, and craggy steeps, the solace that seductive nature bore, and how in my late teens I came to you with other Radcliffe pagans suckled in a creed outworn, declaiming whole swatches of intonations to each other, moist-eyed with reverence, lying about the common room, rising to recite, Great God, I'd rather be. How else redeem the first flush of experience? How else create it again? Not an entire forgetfulness. I raise up my boyfriend, a Harvard man, who could outquote me in his groveling elocutionary style. Groping to unhook my bra, he swore poetry could change the world for the better. The war was on. Was I to let him die unfulfilled? Soon after we parted, years later, he, a decorated vet, I, a part-time professor, signed the same guest book in the Lake District. Stunned by coincidence, we gingerly shared the room. Ah, well, high summer now, how many more of these? Fair seed time had my soul, you sang. What seed times still to come? How I mistrust them, cheaters that will flame, gutter, go out, like the scarlet tanager who lights in the apple tree but will not stay. Here at the pond, your meadow, grove, and stream lodged in my head as tight as lily buds, Sun slants through translucent minnows, dragonflies in paint box colors couple in midair. The fickle tanager flies over the tasseled field. I lay my prelude down under the willow. My old gnarled body prepares to swim to the other side. Come with me, Will. Let us cross over, sleek as otters, each of us bobbing the old-fashioned breaststroke, each of us centered in our beloved veils. While there's thinking of Gorky while clearing the trail, imagining Marianne Moore in the butterfly garden, and there's a Gerard Manley Hopkins one, and Ariel Rukeyser and Rilke. Little known facts about Rainer Maria Rilke. Rilke revisited. Carrying a single long-stemmed iris, you walk through Prague dressed entirely in black, an uncooked bard whose work, according to Lou Andreas Salome, is florid, romantic, and obscure. She makes you change your name, Rene, at birth, revise your crabbed long hand, and put your infantilized white feet on wet grass. You work at a stand-up desk to force the sluggish blood down to your numb appendages. You become a vegetarian. You breakfast on imported Quaker oats, and then come lovers, fans, translators, your name on the tongues of literati, your angels somersault, then hover in midair. I feel them pass by, causing the tips of my hair to rise crackling from the sidewise swipe of their wings. I think I should have glossed that by saying that Rilke's poetry is just full of angels. That might have helped a little. Can you stand another manure pile? Seems like a lot to ask, but I'll do it anyway. It's called the Brown Mountain. I mean, this is an education for those of you who are not rural. The Brown Mountain. What dies out of us and our creatures, out of our fields and gardens, comes slowly back to improve us. The entire map of nasturtiums after frost has blackened down. Sunflower heads the birds have picked clean, the still sticky stalks of milkweed torn from the pasture. Coffee grounds, eggshell, moldy potatoes, the tough little trees that once were crowded with Brussels sprouts, tomatoes cat-faced or bitten into by inquisitive chipmunks, gargantuan cucumbers gone soft from repose. Not the corn stalks and shucks, not windfall apples. These are sanctified by horses. The lettuces are revised as rabbit pellets holding with nitrogen. Whatever fodder is offered the sheep comes back to us as raisins of useful dung. Compost is our future. The turgid Brown Mountain steams, releasing the devil's own methane vapor, cooking our cast-offs, so that from our spatterings and embarrassments, cat vomit, macerated mice, rotten squash, burst berries, a mare's placenta, fail urine, dog hair, hoof parings, arises a rapture of blackest humus. Dirt to top dress, dig in. Dirt fit for the gardens of Cumberland. I'm going to read a poem that's in a voice, and I guess you could call this a dramatic monologue. I know that you all know Browning's Last Duchess, so you know what a monologue is. This is in a voice of a young man, actually now in Seattle, leading a successful life in a suit and tie. who was one of the lost boys of the civilian victims of the Civil War that drove them across the desert. And it's in his voice pretty much. It's called William Remembers the Outbreak of Civil War. The year was 1983. I took off my clothes and walked naked. There were people killing boys just for their clothes. I walked with the rest of my Dinka clan 1,000 kilometers in single file. We blistered our feet in the desert dirt, the flyaway dirt of southern Sudan. If my mother sat down beside me today, I wouldn't know her. My father was one of the elders who put us out on the march with our cooking pots and killing sticks before he got ready to shake hands with death in the war that was always coming. I was too little to carry a dang, a pole with a hand grip carved out of tree roots. Khartoumers made fun of us, calling us stupid stick people, tagbondo. All that wasn't long ago. I was 6 years old. I had only a shirt. Lots of us dropped out along the way, recruited to join guerrilla bands, given machetes, beer, even guns. The oldest, 16. In the refugee camp in Kakuma, I learned English, team sports, shower and soap, fork and spoon. I studied geography, read Lord Jim, and coached younger boys in basketball, a game made for Dinkas. Even skinny and homesick, we're the tallest tribe in the world, it was written. The war never ended. The camp overflowed. Some people from the UN came to see the city of lost boys lodged in this settlement. One of them sent me a pair of Nikes. Nikes, my first shoes. The day those shoes came, I was king, let me tell you, king of the camp. Framed against buildings in gray suit and tie, tall, handsome William, whose birthday less, but guesses he's 22 or 3, a shipping clerk now in the Western world, says, truly my whole life, I never knew where I would put my head down at night, what I would eat, what day I would eat it, what day my head would drop off my shoulders. Now I am at my highest place yet. I sleep without fear. I eat without hoarding. But I worry about all the other boys of the Dinka clan I left behind in that Kakuma camp with their useless bangs and their cooking pots and no relatives. No kin to turn to, as long as they live. I'm trying to think of something just a little bit lighter after that. John Green takes his Warner, New Hampshire neighbor to a Red Sox game. That's the town I come from. John Green takes his Warner, New Hampshire neighbor to a Red Sox game. Everett down the hill's 52 and trim, no beer gut, raises beef, corn, hay, cuts cordwood between harvests, goes to bed at 8 and falls into sleep like a parachutist. He's never been to a ball game. He's never been to Boston, though he went over to Portland, Maine one time 10, 15 years ago. In Sullivan Square, they luck out, find a space for John's car, take the T to Fenway Park, the famous T. A kind of underground trolley runs in the dark. No motorman that Ev can see, jammed with other sports fans. John has to show him how to put the token in, how to press with his hips to go through the turnstile, how to stand back while the doors whoosh shut, how to grab a strap as the car pitches forward, how to push out with the surging crowd. Afterward, Ed says the game's a whole lot better on TV. Too many fans, too many other folks for him. And this is, it's funny how the older you get, the farther back you seem to be able to reach. This is called flying. When Mother was little, all she knew about flying was what her bearded grandfather told her. Every night your soul flies out of your body and into God's lap. He keeps it under his handkerchief until morning. Hearing this as a child haunted me. I couldn't help sleeping. I woke up each morning groping as for a lost object lodged perhaps between my legs, never knowing what had been taken from me or what had been returned to its harbor. When, as a new grandmother, my mother first flew cross country, the name of the airline escapes me, but the year was 1947. She consigned her soul to the Coco Chanel costumed stewardess, then ordered a straight up martini. As they landed, the nose wheel wobbled and dropped away. Some people screamed. My mother was not one of them, but her shoes, she had slipped them off, somersaulted forward. Deplaning, she took out her handkerchief and reclaimed her soul from the ashen stewardess. That night, in a room not her own, under eaves heavy with rain and the rue of a disbelieving daughter, my mother described her grandfather to me, a passionate man who carried his soul wedged deep in his pants watch pocket, a pious man whose red beard had never seen scissors, who planted his carrots and beets in the dark of the moon for good reason, and who, before I was born, rose up like Elijah, flew straight away up to heaven. Okay, I'm going to read a... This poem goes back to the Vietnam War. I realize that you were all born after that, but my son was a war resistor. He was arrested twice for civil disobedience, and finally I marched too, but the only group I could go with, the only really active group in our suburb, was the Catholic Mothers Against the War. So here's this poem, and it's called Angel. It's written in three line stanzas, and I think you'll hear the lines. When I have something difficult to say, I always write in form, because the form gives me the permission, and then I get to say what I need to say. You didn't have to be a Catholic mother to march with the Catholic mothers against the war and lie in front of the Navy Yard buses waiting to ferry recruits to their berths in Boston Harbor. You didn't have to be any kind of mother. One was a priest. Two others, nearly fathers. You didn't have to have a war resistor, my 17-year-old son, to serve as advisor, arrested twice for civil disobedience. He knew the holding pen they put us in, 30 middle-class and mostly Catholic women. He stood up with his father and the bondsman. The whole world was watching. Nothing I could have done back then in self-righteousness would have impeded my body's downward slippage. I am too old now to go to jail for my conscience, to wait to be processed, dismissed with a click of the stapler. These days I take them by the hand, each woman I walk to the door of the clinic, past the chants of murderer, baby killer. Who are the harassers? My old compatriots' granddaughters? What a long purgatory life is. A tethered dog on the lawn next door, forever struggling against the circle he carves for himself, wearing his claws to stumps in the hard path, awaiting the angel he summons with his bride, the angel who comes at last to unfasten his collar. Well, these are getting darker and darker. I'm sorry about that. Seems to me I should go back and find some one other light poem before I dive into the last two pretty dark ones. Thereby sparing our fence boards from the deep curves seen elsewhere on poor Mount Ponds. And then it is spring. Dr. Green arrives, rich with dandelions, grown grass, and clover. The 6-foot spindles of now naked popples flutter the paddock, the lawn, the roadside. You insist they must be gathered and stacked to be sawn. Someone can burn them, they make a quick fire. As quick as newspaper, I say, I want to hurl them into the gully. Let nature do the recycling. Of course you win. After living so long a time side by side, I know how to choose what quarrels not to pick. And so in the chartreuse days of April, we work together, stacking by size, neat piles of trash wood to gladden the eye, wood enough for the hereafter. Now we've arrived at the last two poems in the book. Some of you know that the late Anne Sexton was my dear friend, and that she took her own life in 1974. I carried that with me every day of my life, I would say for about 15 years, until I was able to perhaps pass a day without thinking of her, maybe 2 days. A couple of years ago, probably 3 or 4 years ago, I came across a whole stack of yellowed second sheets. You probably don't know what second sheets are, but in the days before the computer, when we typed, we made carbon copies, and the carbons were always made onto these yellow sheets. So that's what I found. I had apparently taken notes, or written down some dreams, and I made a poem. It's called Three Dreams After a Suicide, Anne Sexton, 1974. One, we're gathered in the funeral home, your friends who are not themselves especially friends, with you laid out on view in the approved fashion, wearing the bright red reading dress with cut glass buttons that wink at the ceiling, when you spring like a jack-in-the-box from the coffin, crying, boo, I was only fooling. Two, after the terrible whipping, you are oddly pleased with yourself, an impenitent child, the winner. It's Daddy Death who's quit. Once more you've worn him out from all his lifting and striking. His belt lies shredded in his meaty fist. Three, we are standing together in a sunless garden in Rockport, Mass. I'm wearing the hat the artist painted you in. I'm wearing the hat the artist painted you in, and suddenly swarms of wasps fly up under the downturned brim. Oh, Death, where is thy sting? Tar baby, it is sticker to me. You were my boss, and I your Jimmy. And then this is the last poem, sort of my protest protest poem against suicide. All of the suicidal poets and one novelist are in it. There's Hart Crane and John Berryman, Plath, Sexton, Hemingway. I think that's it. It's called Oblivion. The dozen ways they did it, off a bridge, the back of a boat, pills, hits in the oven, or wrapped in her mother's old mink coat in the garage, a brick on the accelerator, the cougar's motor thrumming while she crossed over. What they left behind, the outline of a stalled novel, diaries, their best poems, the note that ends, "Now will you believe me?" Offspring of various ages, spouses who cared and weep, and yet admit relief now that it's over. How they fester, the old details, held to the light like a stained glass icon. The shotgun in the mouth, the string from toe to trigger, the tongue of blue plum forced between his lips when he hanged himself in her closet. For us, it is never over. Who raced to the scene, cut the noose, pulled the bathtub plug on pink water, broke windows, turned off the gas, rode in the ambulance, only minutes later to take the body blow of bad news. We are trapped in the plot, everyone. Left behind, there is no oblivion. Thank you all very much. Anybody else brave enough to raise a hand while I'm up here? Yes. Anybody else? I just put all of the little scraps there and go away. And then when I'm looking for a poem to write, when the well is dry, I go to the bone pile. And sometimes something just jumps out and wants to be worked on, and so then I select it and copy it onto a new page, as it were, and go from there. I used to do it on the typewriter. Now I'm so sophisticated, I do it on my Mac. The reason I have a Mac is my son, who is a computer wizard, says it's the only possible computer for